We're not finished. Lots more to come. Our next speaker is Robert Venables. He's taught in various places. He's run museums. He's sought for a long time to tell the true history of relations between our peoples, and at times has suffered from that in a similar way to Jake talked about what Haudenosaunee people have experienced within that educational system. And joining Bob in the procession, which wasn't, they didn't come down because his longtime friend and colleague, Irv Paulus, isn't able to walk down the stairs at this point. But for over 30 years, they've worked together. And in fact, much of what Bob now knows was taught to him by Irv. And unlike many other Western scholars, Bob was open to learning from Irv and to then seeking to go out through our Western system to confirm or deny the oral history that Irv told him. And time and again, he found that when he did the research and looked deeply enough, that in fact the history did confirm the Haudenosaunee oral teachings. So Bob is going to talk briefly with us about some of the violations of the treaties and things that allies have done to work with and support justice for the Haudenosaunee and other Native peoples. Robert Venables.
I'd like to thank the Peace Council and the Onondaga Nation, and I'd also like to thank Maurice Hinchey for being here, because he is one of the leaders of the new conscience of North America. One of the things that I'm going to talk about tonight is why there has been such a failure to keep the two-row. And Maurice Hinchey is an example of what to do instead of what not to do. So thank you, Congressman. Andy wasn't kidding when he said that the attitudes that I have are largely the result of my friendship with Irv Paulus. In 1971, I walked into his home, and for 3 years, he batted me over the head, telling me that my ideas, although they were well argued, were not the whole story. And it took 3 years. It was painful. But eventually, I saw that there was a different way of viewing things. Even though I regarded myself as open-minded when I got there, my friend Irv Paulus has completely stirred up my brain. And it continues to do that. Now, when Jack Mano said, you're going to speak on the violations of the two-row, I said, well, how long do I have? And he said, 10 minutes. And I said, 500 years of violations in 10 minutes. How am I going to do that? Because as Jack knows, I used to lecture for 3 hours straight. I've got my clock right here, so I'm not going to go by my 10 minutes. But I'm going to start with why the two-row has been broken and why there is hope that maybe, just maybe, the people in this audience and people, like-minded people around the world, not just in the Western Hemisphere, are turning around the concept that lies at the betrayal of the two-row. There are three words that lie at the betrayal of the two-row. Doctrine of discovery. In 1492, European nations had the gall to believe that God gave them any land they sighted. And the state of New York and the United States and Canada and Mexico and all of the countries of the Western Hemisphere still believe in the doctrine of discovery. It is a one-row philosophy. There is no room, as long as the nations of the Western Hemisphere adhere to the doctrine of discovery, there is no room to think anything except one row. People have tried well-intentioned Europeans tried, well-intentioned white Americans tried. In 1550, a Catholic priest by the name of Bartholomew de las Casas, who had originally been a conquistador, and then he encouraged the bringing over of African slaves so that Indians wouldn't be enslaved. And then he realized that was wrong. And in his 70s, he went before Charles V, the emperor of the Holy Roman Empire and the monarch of Spain. And he argued for an entire year on behalf of justice, peace for native peoples throughout the Western Hemisphere. It's a wonder he wasn't burned at the stake. Listen to this quote. He's talking about the Indian people. "Why will they believe such a proud, greedy, cruel, and rapacious nation? Why will they give up the religion of their ancestors, unanimously approved for so many centuries and supported by the authority of their teachers on the basis of a warning from a people at whose words there are no miracles to confirm the faith or to lessen the vice?" He went on, but when Charles V finished listening, the opponent of Las Casas won the debate. The opponent's name was Sepulveda. In Los Angeles, there is a major boulevard called Sepulveda. You want to see how pervasive the subversion of two-row thinking is? You just have to think of Sepulveda, because he was the one who was opposed to Las Casas, and Las Casas lost. But he gave it a good fight. Why did he lose? I think he lost because his bottom line was, we will be patient, we will be loving, we will seek justice, but eventually Native Americans will come around to Christianity, Native Americans will come around to white government. That's the underpinning of virtually every reform movement in the Western Hemisphere. One of the great writers of the 19th century, Helen Hunt Jackson, wrote A Century of Dishonor, and she castigated the United States for the cruelties against American Indians. But her bottom line was, if we are patient, if we are loving, if we seek our form of justice, Indians will convert to Christianity, Indians will become governed by the same kind of institutions that we have. John Collier, Commissioner of Indian Affairs in the 1930s, actually believed sincerely that if you protected American Indian religion and protected American Indian cultures, Indians could adapt white forms of government and survive. How absurd. You cannot separate Native religious beliefs from government. You cannot separate their philosophies from government. But now we are beginning to see a turn. No one is surprised when they see a two-row. They are realizing, if they're non-Indians, that there are ways of thinking that other people have that are valid paths to get us through this life. And you are part of the start of that generation that's going to do that, that's going to remind people that the truth is a long way away, and there are many paths to that truth. If you're opposed to drones, every time you talk about the drones, remember the Sullivan campaign. Remember Van Schaack's Rape of Onondaga in 1779. It's the same policy. Nothing has changed unless you change it, unless you convince the government, unless you convince the philosophers that the best way is the two-row, allowing people to go their separate ways under their separate governments, linked in beads of friendship. Thank you very much.
So encourage folks to stick around. We're about to have a wonderful multimedia presentation about the two-row campaign to learn a lot more about what's coming up, what you can do, how you can be part of this tremendous year to come. So Lindsay, Speer, and HIckory Edwards.
So we have heard about the history, and we have heard about some of the violations of that history, and we've heard some hope for the future. And that's why HIckory and I are up here, because there's hope for the future. The two-row is not just about the past. It's not just about 400 years ago. Our campaign isn't just about the past and 400 years ago. It's about now and the present, and for the future as well. As neighbors of the Onondaga Nation, we've been working with the Onondaga Nation for over 13 years, working in peace and friendship. The first thing we had to do was learn to listen, just like Bob had to learn how to listen. It's a tough thing to do, but we learned. And the thing we kept hearing was about this two-row, about this agreement that we will travel the river of life side by side and not try to steer each other's boats. And as neighbors of the Onondaga Nation, we really found that to be a good guidebook. It's a way for us to understand how to be good allies. It's a way for us to understand how to move down the river of life together with the Onondaga Nation and with the Haudenosaunee. So you can see in some of the pictures behind me, there's been a long relationship, there's been a long partnership between our peoples. Well, it's actually really short when it comes down to the recent history. But we're working on, once the United States, the New York State government have been fighting, the New York State government has been fighting the Onondaga Nation's land rights action. And so there hasn't been justice found in our courts yet. And Things aren't looking so good. So what has to happen is we have to be part of this solution. We have to be a land rights movement. We have to listen to the message of healing and the message of respect for the environment that the Onondaga Nation has been bringing to us, that our Haudenosaunee allies have been bringing to us, and take that and move forward with it. It's up to us. If our government won't do it, then it's up to us. And it's up to us to be steering our ship. And that means talking to our elected officials. And it means educating our friends and neighbors. Environmental work is clearly part of what we've been doing. As neighbors of the Onondaga Nation, we've been part of the no fracking movement, trying to keep hydrofracking out of New York State. We've been working on making sure the cleanup of Onondaga Lake goes well, as has the Onondaga Nation. And together, we can work to protect that river of life that we both live in. Want to add anything to begin with? We've been out tabling a lot of different events and been talking to people across New York State in the last year as we've geared up for the two-row campaign. And a little bit wide. And we've had a lot of support from people, a lot of interest from people, and so we're really glad to have all of you here tonight as we begin this campaign. HIckory, you're going to talk about, HIckory's going to talk about the trip itself.
Yeah, my name is HIckory Edwards. Well, we're going to be starting from Onondaga Nation, the central fire of the Haudenosaunee people, meeting of the Grand Council of Chiefs. So we're going to be starting out from Onondaga Nation and paddling through the ancient water trails of our people, which will draw. Onondaga Creek to Onondaga Lake of the Seneca River to Oneida Lake, then Erie Canal to the Mohawk River, down to the Great Hudson River, and finally ending up into Manhattan and crossing Manhattan over to the United Nations building. After a kickoff event in Albany, I'm kind of getting nervous. So if I look at you guys weird, I'm picturing you naked. So, all right. So we'll be going down the Hudson River in two rows, side by side down the river of life, basically conveying the ideals of the two-row in peace, friendship, and in parallel forever down the river of life. We'll be traveling alongside of a land crew, which will have all the events set up, food preparation, and a lot of other stuff to help with the travel down the Hudson River. A lot of setup for lacrosse demonstrations and other events at town hall meetings, museums, schools, and So this is about it for Lindsay.
Sure.
So as HIckory mentioned, they're going to start at Onondaga. And so on July 2nd, there's going to be, they'll be taking off from Onondaga, and we're going to join them at the Inner Harbor and paddle across Onondaga Lake. And there'll be an event at Willow Bay. And we really look forward to having a lot of people with us. The next video you're going to see is going to show the path of the Hudson River trip. And we've been working with people along the Hudson River. There's, like HIckory said, there's going to be lots of different events along the way, educational events, lacrosse events, environmental events, and we're always looking for more people to get involved. The original sign-up date was by January 31st, but we've extended that to April 1st, and that's not a joke. And so we encourage anyone who's interested in joining us on the canoe paddle down the Hudson River as we enact the vision that's put in the two-row, traveling side by side, Haudenosaunee and allies. Please sign up, it's on our website, and we look forward to hearing from you. There's lots of ways you can get involved in the campaign, both with the events of the enactment in the summer, which is starting on the 27th of Albany, of course, with a large event in Albany, 27th of July, sorry, with a large event in Albany. And then starting on the 28th, we'll launch and then travel down to meet in New York City by the 9th of August for the United Nations International Day of Indigenous Peoples. I encourage everyone, if you're excited by what we're doing, to come out to our meeting next week. A week from tonight, we're meeting at 6 o'clock. I believe it's at the Westcott Community Center. There's details on our website, and it should be in your program, to have an all-involved meeting, to talk about all the different committees that we're all working on. We have committees for media. We've got committees planning the enactment. We have committees working to do outreach with groups around the state. We have committees that are working on educational events. There's lots of ways to get involved. We really welcome everyone's engagement. And of course, there's lots of other events that are happening too. There's an event happening at Cornell. There's events happening in New Paltz. There's a bunch of them are in your program. There's more online. And please, when you go out to our lobby for the refreshments, there's places to sign up to get involved, and there's more information on all of the tables. Let's see here. So, go back to the PowerPoint. Great. The goal of the campaign is to increase awareness and the understanding of the history of the relations between the Haudenosaunee, other Native nations in the United States, highlighting the importance of the Two-Row Wampum Treaty and building momentum for respect of indigenous sovereignty by the citizens and government of New York State. And to increase for friendship, to increase the recognition and appreciation of the contemporary Haudenosaunee and other Native nations of New York, their culture, aspirations, worldview, and ecological knowledge. It's a chance for us to actually get to know each other as friends. And for forever, ensuring a sustainable future, we will share the Two-Row Wampum as a model for how we can halt environmental destruction and move forward together towards a sustainable future based on natural law and peace and friendship forever. All right, trailer. Yeah. And this, I hope, gets you a little bit excited. I'm going to call on all of your imaginations to see that footage and think of that as 100 canoes or 200 canoes. We have over 90 people signed up as paddlers already, and again, I hope you join us.
So we've talked a lot about the need for people power to make this effort successful. For many, many of you, your friends, your colleagues, other people to get involved with this work. But there's another resource that's needed in addition to people power, and that's money. So we ask you to think about contributing to the campaign. There's baskets that are beginning to circulate now. Eli, go ahead and pass that down the row, please. No. Pass it to people. Let's go to the back and pass it down. He's new at this. So we'd encourage you to think about opening your wallet, putting in a few dollars, putting in $10, $20, taking out your checkbook and writing a big check. Whatever you can afford to contribute is greatly appreciated. We also will be continuing to raise money for the campaign. The silent auction outside is part of that. And encourage people to go to the website and donate that way too, through PayPal or other online kinds of things. So we really need both grassroots funding to make this work, as well as what we've been doing, seeking grants from foundations, from organizational co-sponsors, et cetera. So really encourage and appreciate your generosity. And while those baskets are circulating, I believe there's a song that Jake Edwards had requested that we play, which is a Johnny Cash song about treaty violations. So can cue that up, sound, folks, please.
As long as the river flows, as long as the sun will shine, as long as the grass shall grow. The Senecas are an Indian tribe of the Iroquois Nation. Down on the New York, Pennsylvania line, you'll find their reservation. After the U.S. Revolution, Corn Planter was a chief. He told the tribe these men they could trust. That was his true belief. He went down to Independence Hall, and there a treaty signed that promised peace with the USA and Indian rights combined. George Washington gave his signature. The government gave its hand. They said that now and forevermore that this was Indian land. As long as the moon shall rise, as long as the river flow, as long as the sun will shine, as long as the grass shall grow. On the Seneca reservation, there is much sadness now. Washington's treaty has been broken, and there is no hope, no how. Across the Allegheny River, they're throwing up a dam. It will flood the Indian country, a proud day for Uncle Sam. It has broke the ancient treaty with a politician's grin. It will drown the Indian graveyards. Corn planter, can you swim? The earth is mother to the Senecas. They're trampling sacred ground. Change the mint green earth to black mud flats as honor hobbles down. As long as the moon shall rise, as long as the river flows, as long as the sun will shine, as long as the grass shall grow. The Iroquois Indians used to rule from Canada.
So have a couple of little closing pieces, so encourage folks who can to stick around. If you do need to go, be sure to check out the tables outside. Do some bidding on the silent auction as well. So Regina Jones is going to share some closing remarks, and then Sally Roesch Wagner is going to close out the evening with some thoughts on how we can honor the Turo. So Regina Jones.
Before I introduce our final speaker and invite everyone to a reception outside in the lobby, I'd just like to express my gratitude for you all coming and hope you find other ways to get involved. It's an important event. So it's my honor to introduce my friend and our sister in spirit, Sally Roesch Wagner. She's a Noon member and the executive director of the Matilda Joslyn Gage Foundation in Fayetteville, New York. I'm actually just going to read from the back cover of her book, Sisters in Spirit. Dr. Sally Roesch Wagner is a feminist pioneer, speaker, activist, and the author of several books and numerous articles. Dr. Wagner was one of the first to receive a PhD for work in women's studies in Santa Cruz, University of California, and is a founder of one of the nation's first women's studies programs, California State University in Sacramento. She has appeared in the Ken Burns documentary, Not for Ourselves Alone, and in the PBS special, One Woman, One Vote. Ladies and gentlemen, it's our final speaker, and then we can enjoy a reception. My friend, Sally Roesch Wagner.
Well, I have the honor to share with you the thoughts of the Turo Wampum campaign about some of the things that we can all do and think about in making the change that Bob Venables so eloquently invited us to be part of. In terms of friendship, we can learn about the people indigenous to wherever we are, clear our minds of all stereotypes, don't co-opt indigenous cultures, support native craftspeople, businesses, and events, learn the true history. Celebrate Indigenous Peoples Day instead of Columbus Day. Read Native authors. Distinguish among Native nations. Learn their stories. Get to know our Indigenous neighbors and make friends. Consider what it means to be an ally. Working for peace. Learn about the treaties and our obligations. End cultural domination. Read and promote the UN Declaration on the Rights of Indigenous People. Respect and promote Indigenous sovereignty. Demand that our government treat Native nations fairly. Listen more than we talk. Remember that treaties are the supreme law of the land, according to Article 6 of the U.S. Constitution. Learn about and repudiate the doctrine of discovery. Forever sharing the environment, we must care for the earth, not pollute, not waste, be environmentally responsible, grow and eat local foods, learn about the gifts of indigenous agronomists to our food supply. Women invented corn. Consider the consequences of your actions. Slow down and notice where we're needed and where we are. Buy only what we need and overcome the feeling that we're entitled to more. Use native plants in our gardens and give thanks frequently. Thank you.
Thank you again for coming. Please join us for refreshments, for socializing, bid on the auction, which will close in a half hour from now, and sign up to get involved. Thank you.